is family?
A family is a group of people that love each other and they have sisters and brothers. Care for you.
Be loving to you.
That you love each other and that no matter what happens, you always be with each other.
When someone is sad, you give them a hug.
They help us and provide us shelter and food.
This is a speaker.
What's the most important thing about family?
To respect each other and love each other and show how much you love them.
Do you love your family?
Yes.
How much?
Universe. I need to wash the dishes and set the table.
Yeah.
I have to hang up the washing.
What's your favourite thing about your siblings?
Hanging out with each other.
What do you love most about Mum?
Her kindness.
They make you dinner. They care for you. And they make you breakfast. They make ears. Dish us and tickle us.
They tackle you?
Tickle us.
Oh, tickle you.
And tackle us.
And cuddle.
Well, that's... And kiss.
And kiss. Is that fun? Do you like it? Is that because you know they love you?
Yeah. I love Mummy and Daddy.
Who's your favourite, Mummy or Daddy?
Mummy!
What do you think is the most important thing about family?
Be encouraged.
Mommy and Daddy, they come at night. They come and say prayers, and then a bit after, I'll say prayers to myself.
Can you sing us a song?
All is calm. All is bright. Sleep in heavenly
we're doing right now. In case you missed it, they are all families in this church that are making those videos. This morning, we're going to be focusing on family. And then tonight, I'd really encourage you to come back. Pastor Anna's going to be talking about dating tonight, so that'll be one to come along to as well. Pastor Stu Cameron was meant to be speaking this morning. He's probably watching right now online, but he was feeling a little bit unwell. He's doing fine, but just feeling a little unwell over the weekend. So Pastor Mike called me up and said, "Hey, John, we need to find someone to preach on Sunday morning." I said, "Well, I'm not doing it, Mike, so you need to come up with some other suggestions, because that's a 24 hours notice, and there's not many people that can prepare a message in 24 hours. There's a small group of people that can do that." And so we thought, let's contact one of our elders. And so we have the amazing Dr. Daniel Pampuch. We gave him 24 hours notice. He was getting on a plane, and we said, "Hey, would you be willing to put together a message as you fly back from wherever he was for Sunday morning?" But he's an incredible communicator. For those who don't know Daniel, he is married to Tanya Pampuch. She's often on the keys back here and also provides other leadership in our church. Daniel, I first met him about 3 years ago over in Chicago, out of all places, when we were at the Global Leadership Summit over there. And he had just taken on a new position as the Chief Executive Officer of Christian Schools Australia. That is a network of about 165 Christian schools representing about 65,000 students. Prior to that, he was also a principal at a Christian high school. So we really have the privilege of hearing from him this morning. As I mentioned, he's just an amazing communicator with a real heart for the Lord. So can we please put our hands together, give a warm new life welcome to Dr. Daniel Pampuch.
Good morning. It is so good to be with you this morning. And we do begin our series, and the series is around family. And the element that I want to focus on this morning is family finds a way. And so as we go to begin and look and delve into that thought and that series and this theme this morning, I'd just like to pray and just invite God to be with us. Would you join me, please? Father God, we come from all different spaces to be here this morning, from different families and different relationship structures and different circumstances. And so, Lord, as you've gathered us here, we pray that you would open our hearts, you'd open our minds, you'd open our spirits to receive a word from you, that we might take some gem that we know is from you that we can apply to our lives. Father, we thank you that we're here. We're here to gather under your name, and we pray that you would be very much present amongst us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Stu Cameron, our lead minister, often refers to New Life as one big, happy, dysfunctional family. And that seems to be right, isn't it? But if we actually ask the question, what is a family? Some people think that, or that was popular probably 20 or 30 years ago, was that we used to refer to this family as a nuclear family. And if I was to say to teenagers today the concept of a nuclear family, probably the image that comes to mind is them doing something wrong and mum going, nuclear. And we're not talking about that in terms of great reactions, etc. It's saying, what is the heart, or what is that little piece, or those pieces that come together to make us a unit, a little structure together? And today we don't usually think of family as mum and dad and kids, because the world has changed. People have moved away. Structures and circumstances are very different. And some people will refer to family nowadays as the group of people you are most likely to share a meal with on a regular occasion. And I like the idea of that, because it just allows a very open way of thinking about who we come together. And that could be people flatting together. It can be the widowed. It could be the orphaned. It could be, you know, relationships that are going through changes or struggles. It's a very open one. When we look at God, we see that God himself is very much relationship. We see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we see even the God that we worship, in the essence of who he is a relational God. He exists in his own little unit. And that coming together in that way that's held together, there's a word for that that is called perichoresis. Some use a very simple word, because that's a very hard one to say, is the divine dance. That here we have that these three are in constant connection, in motion, and complement each other, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So from this God who is a relational God, we see that he then makes human beings. And in Genesis, we see that Adam is created, and God looks upon Adam and notices something, that it wasn't good for Adam to be by himself or to be alone. And so from that, we see that he creates Eve, and we see the concept of a family, that people were designed to travel and journey together. At the heart of the story are two key relationships, a vertical relationship, to say a love and an understanding of our God, and also a horizontal relationship, which is our relationship with others. And upon that, we can do all these other things. We can journey together and do life. And because we have those key relationships with God and with other, we are able to do more in relationship, through relationship, and with others. We find that relationships find a way, make a way. And families, this morning I want to put to you, always find a way through. No matter the circumstance that you find yourself in, no matter the context, no matter who is around you, when you have a group of relationships that forms that family basis for you, there is an ability to find a way. I've been married for 17 very happy years. My wife's at the back. Extremely happy years. But I was single till I was 29 before getting married. And when you're single, you can do what you please. You get up when you please. You go to work. You choose where you're going to live. You choose what you're going to eat. You choose how you're going to spend your recreation, etc. It is very much centered around the me. When we look onto media or TV or places, we're even encouraged to that. You know, if you go to a movie cinema, the first thing you hear is, you wanted surround sound. You've got it. You wanted a comfortable seat. You've got it. And it is as we're encouraged in every part of our lives to think what it is that we want. But marriage isn't founded on me. It is founded on us. And so when you get married, for some, or you commit to a relationship or to journey with somebody or a group of people, you realize for the first time how selfish you actually are. But over that time, and you think, oh, I've got to give and flow with this other person who's in my life. And then there comes to a point where you go, do you know what? We've got that flow going pretty well in our family. We've got this, you know, my wife and I, we're doing really well. Let's do something. Let's bring a child into the world. And when you have a child, you realize how much selfishness is still left there to go in terms of doing things. Where this little person just has these needs. 2 a.m., 5 a.m., when you're driving the car, whenever. That child demands of you that you die to self and focus on them. And if you think you're doing well at that, have another one. And you can see that there is still more to keep dying to self, to keep putting others first. But there's also a unit that is formed and developed. And we can keep going and we can keep adding to that all the way through. And we can go to the point then where we're now growing and adding to this family. And we can bring in other family members. We can bring in our grandparents. We can bring in sick people, etc. And that family just keeps us dying to self. And so as we become less and less about ourselves, as that family and that relationship structure grows. Ephesians challenges us in this way. Submit to one another in reverence for Christ. The more you move into family, the less there is of self. And one of the key secrets to family, to relationship, to love, is selflessness. Mark 10:45 puts it this way. Even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom. And so in terms of building that very basic block in your life, there is a point that if you are desperate and you're wanting to be in relationship, there is a cost, and that first cost is putting others first. Families also find a way through sacrifice. You know when you're a parent because you're the one who gets to eat the crust. You're the one who opens the punnet to find that there is less than a scoop left of ice cream. You're the one who wears the old clothes while your children wear the new ones. You put off holidays so children can get their teeth fixed, play sport. You put off your needs to do sport runs, to do school drop-offs, to pick up the groceries. However, sacrifice is also a sign of maturity. Babies don't sacrifice anything. They receive. Sacrifice is a sign of maturity. Those who are amongst us who are the most mature often have lives that have just strewn with sacrifice. Galatians 2:20 says, I've been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And we see that in our God, the God who represents perfect relationship of his willingness to give of himself. You know, I don't know about in your family, but in the families that I know, and including my own family, it is the youngest ones who seem to get away with doing the least and sacrificing the least. The youngest one in our household is a little beauty, a little four-year-old, and she's a blonde-headed sweetheart, cute as a button. And boy, does she get away with mischief. She's young, and so we just know she's self-focused. To give you an idea, in the mornings, she has no trouble in terms of just waking us up when she's awake. She will just toddle in and make sure that we're awake. If we were to make a snack for ourselves, my wife and I, if we leave it and it's in reach of her, she'll eat it. When we are finally having a moment to ourselves on the couch, our little girl will plonk herself in between us to ensure that she is the centre of all that we do. And not only that, we have to be constantly careful that if we left the front door open or something, she would wander off. I think you should meet her. I'm sure your house maybe have a fur baby or this is somebody important in your life as well. I joke, of course, but this is so true of our children and even us. Sacrifice and its close friend service defines our walk to maturity. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10, we're challenged this. Have the attitude in yourself which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by being obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And we see that in Jesus, is that the significance and his desire to be in relationship was that sacrifice to the point of death. Tomorrow is Remembrance Day, the 11th of the 11th. And it's a really represents and captures for us the sacrifice that was made for many young men. They were prepared to die that other generations such as ours could understand and appreciate, to have the freedoms that we experience and the peace that we experience today. In World War I, 19 million young people, young men and women, gave their lives. 23 more million were wounded and hurt. One third of those went to a grave and nobody even knows where they ended up. Their sacrifice without being known. In Australia, we had about 330,000 troops who left and 60,000 who never came back. But a further 156,000 would return, wounded, gassed, or having been taken prisoner. There's no doubt in my mind why these men and women became mates, a band of brothers, family to each other. They were willing to lay down their lives at a moment's notice. When the whistle blew and they went over the walls, they were prepared to face imminent death. John chapter 15 challenges this. There is no greater love than a person will be willing to lay down their life for another. We may not have to face death as a soldier, but nonetheless, Jesus challenges us to take up our cross and follow him and live a life that is marked by sacrifice. So we see that there is a selflessness to what we do. There is a sacrifice to what we do. But we also see in the life of Jesus before he gave that sacrifice that he lived a life that was willing to be of service as well. In John, we see chapter 13 that when Jesus finished washing their feet, he returned to his place and he said, "Don't you understand what I've done for you?" he asked him. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you must also wash one another's. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor the messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them." The challenge before us is to serve those around us. And Corinthians 10:24 says, "Let no one seek their own good, but that of his own neighbour." And so when we're looking to see who comes into our world, who may be part of these wide, broad groups we call family, we have to ask and be challenged to ourselves, are we actually prepared to serve? And I was amazed a couple of years ago when I witnessed my in-laws of my family. They received a phone call from a pastor in Hungary, and he said to them, "We are sending an old member of our congregation to Australia. She's 92. She used to live in Australia and she wants to return back to a family she once knew to spend the last couple of years of her life. What she's done at our end, she's given her house away to a young couple in the church. She sold up all of her possessions. She said her last goodbyes and she will arrive in Australia at Brisbane Airport in a week or two time. Can you arrange for someone to pick her up and take her to a house that she's looking for?" And so on the day she arrived, a member of the congregation was sent to pick her up. And old Julia came out at 92 years of age, and the lovely lady said to her, "Where am I going to take you, Julia?" She said, "I don't know the street address." A bit worried at that point. I don't know if I would have left the car park at this stage. And she said, "But just start driving, and I'm sure as you get closer and closer, I'll see landmarks and know where to go." Brisbane over the last decade and a bit's probably changed. So as they started driving, it got later and later and later. And after several hours of driving, they conceded the fact that they were not going to get to the house that night. So what they did was they placed Julia, because she'd been travelling from overseas and she'd been in the car for hours in a hotel, and they resumed the search in the morning. The next morning, my father-in-law, Eugene, went to see her. And they talked about who these people were, trying to find a way of making that connection in her last years of her life, that she could be with people she loved. And what he found out was that one of the people had actually passed away from old age and the other one was in a nursing home. What were they to do with this lady who had sold up everything that she had and had now come to be with a group that she wanted to spend the last of her life with? And so with no other options before her, they took her into their home. Not for a day, not for a week, but months and months and months. And there's a real challenge in there, isn't it? Because a family has a posture of service. A family is always caring and looking out for one another. A family is there ready with a tea towel. They're ready to flick in a few dollars when in time of need. They're happy to take on little ones and care for them. And they're happy to open up their homes and bring somebody else in. The congregations of the Bible in the early days were not big buildings or cathedrals or places of spectacular prominence. They were people's homes. They met together, they ate together, they shared their finances with each other, they supported each other, and from that abundance, they were able to support people like Paul as missionaries. But how is that possible? How do you get a disparate group, a dysfunctional family like us together, and somehow act as a family? Galatians 3 challenges them this way. So in Christ, you are children of God through faith. For all of you were baptized into Christ, as we've seen this morning, have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile or Hungarian, neither slave nor free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. We become the family. Families recognize who the true head of the home is, and that is Christ. They understand the values and the reasons behind what they do. They're growing together towards the same goal, which is transformation into the likeness of Christ. Self is put aside and the likeness of Christ is put on. There are not competing agendas, ideologies, or worldly philosophies. It is no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me. At New Life, our posture must be the same. Do we come to serve or do we come to be served? Do we come to see a performance or are we here to participate? And sometimes we don't feel that we're part of families is because of the fact is that we're still part of the receiving. And remember in the family, and I showed you our little family, is that the youngest ones are often the ones who receive. But in the step of maturity and to the ones of growing within that family, we go from being from a receiving posture to a giving and serving posture. There is no better way to feel that you belong in a group or in the church than to start giving. Working shoulder and shoulder with other people as we look to bring and to grow and to help in this community. Get your hands dirty and you'll start to feel like you belong. For some of us, we're in circumstances right now where we're really seeking an answer. And so it's not about being selfless and it's not about sacrifice. And it's not even around some of the things we're doing, but just that we haven't experienced that breakthrough yet. And so the next point I would like to talk to you about is about time. It takes time for sometimes to feel in relationship. It takes time to feel that you are in family. And so maybe one of the breakthroughs that you're looking for this morning is through family, is through time. To give you an example of that, my father, who's in his 80s now, was born in Germany. He was one of five children, and at the time when he was growing up, there were 6 million unemployed people. The only place that he could get food and shelter at that point in time was living with his grandparents. So he was sent off to live with his grandma and granddad, who at this stage had not had children in their home for several decades. And so that whole kind of thing of empty nesting, they had the children return. What they didn't realise was that they had to change some of their habits and behaviours. So they were quite happy to take him out on their trips and they did things like go to botanical gardens, etc. And one time, one of these trips, they went, had a great day together, and then they went home. Except they forgot to take him. And so after several hours of waiting for these people, grandparents who were his new family taking care of him, he decided to hop on a tram. He remembered, Fred, that where mum and dad were was that there was a tram depot beside his house. And Arnie's a little boy, about five or six. He decided to hop on a tram because he knew by the end of that day, the tram would come back to the depot and he would just have to walk across the street back home. Great thinking. So tram comes to the end of its shift. There's little Walter, gets off, walks to the front door, opens the front door and says to his mother, "I'm home. What's for dinner?" Mum's not happy. Mum marches across to grandparents and says to her in-laws and says, "What's happened? You've left little Walter disappear." Walter continued with them in their care for more time. And this time, as they were at the post office, he was left behind again, the major post office in the middle of the city. He decided that where do you go when you're lost? You go to the police office, police station. So there was the headquarters of the police station only around the corner. And so he plonked himself in there and he had a ball of a time, watching robbers get brought in, handcuffed, being processed, prostitutes off the street, people fighting, police officers with their badges and guns, etc. And he sat at the processing desk and watched all of this action appear before him. Lo and behold, came in Granddad, hanging onto his hat, really terrified, not terrified of the police, terrified of his daughter-in-law, to collect young Walter. And when he said to the police officer, "This is my grandson, I'd like to take him home," Walter looked at the police officer and said, "I don't know this man." He was having a ball of a time. And so this relationship that came from being this little boy who was just passed on to somebody else to be cared for, their relationship over time got to the point. And with the promise of a couple of ice creams, he went home with Granddad. In my work, I spend time with the people who head up large institutions and doing complex jobs, often where they're looking for families or communities that may be with 6,000 people or more. And I know that I can't support them in a moment's notice. Getting to know them, understanding their circumstance requires me to take the time to have a cup of coffee, to walk around their facilities, to get to know their journey over time, etc., to be able to speak into their world. And the same it is with a God that we worship as well. We worship a God who is very present, a God who is incarnate and does life with us. And he takes time for us. God also wants to spend time for us to get to know him as well. And for some of us, as we seek to become transformed into the likeness of Christ, we can only do so when we immerse ourselves and take the time in those disciplines of reading our Bible, of prayer and reflection, and that time well spent in him. God also wants to spend time with us so we can get to know him, and he ultimately seeks to spend an eternity with us in relationship and in its fullness. And John 10:28 says, "I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will ever snatch them out of my hand." And that is a comfort to us in any circumstance that we're in. But for some of us, our testimony is one that is marked by struggles and storms and conflict. And that unit of a family is the actual vehicle that we will actually get through those difficulties. You know, it's popular, and if you look at all TV shows or Facebook, etc., to see lives that just seem to be one celebration after another, the next big event that's about to happen. And somehow we are told that relationships, the more parties and brilliant experiences you have, the better relationships that you're in. I would challenge that. I would say to you that the quality of a relationship, the quality of the family you're in, is not how many parties you have, but how many difficulties you get through together. That is the true quality of a relationship and of a family. Think of this as a battleship. If you look at a battleship going off to war, some may judge that battleship with the number of cannons that are on the deck. They may judge it by the speed that boat can travel at, or about its size and capacity of number of sailors on board. But if you are a sailor on that ship and that boat is being torpedoed and bombed, the one thing you want to know is that it'll bring you safely back to shore when it is all over. And in a sense, our families are the battleships of our lives, the things that we journey through to bring us back safely to shore. I remember about 20 years ago when I was just starting off as a green teacher, I was meeting with my boss one afternoon and a single mum walked into the reception and told the secretary that she needed to meet with the principal immediately. She had her son in tow. As the secretary came to let us know that she was here, the mum walked in with the little boy behind her. She looked at the principal square in the eye and she said, "Do you still have a cane?" And he said, "Well, why?" She said, "My boy has been extremely rude and disobedient and I want you to give him six of the best." Let me tell you, that's not what your local school principal is there for in terms of family discipline. He was very wise and he said to her, leave this young boy with me, go home, and I'll make sure that he's home for dinner later this afternoon. And the next couple of hours was spent with that principal, and no, he didn't get the cane, and that was not something that he was fond of. But he spent that time then walking with the boy. He spent the time cleaning up, doing some kind of restorative process in the school, and also challenging him to put off the things of childhood and embrace the things of adulthood. I asked him what was his secret, because he had seemed to do this with such ease and calm and joy even, one might say. What was his secret sauce? What was the secret way that he actually was able to work with teenagers? And he said, my theory is simple. Just get them through it. And that applies not only to teenagers, but it may apply to relatives, it may apply to next-door neighbours and friends, etc. In terms of the circumstances, that ability to weather the storm becomes important. He also knew that by spending some time with this boy, he allowed a bit of space with mum there, that she could actually have a bit of downtime and a bit of breathing space in her own life, and the young boy could get a bit of perspective as well. Colossians 3:13 asks us and challenges us with these words. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave. And over all of these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. We will have conflict and we will have struggles. But having that relationship and that family unit of that group of people around us helps us to weather the storms. But ultimately, family needs to provide a space of safety for people. And that's never more apparent when you have children or you've got people in your home. When you have little people, you seem to have this sixth sense. I can tell when I have one of my boys staring at me when I am asleep. I know there is a face right before me. I've got so good at it, I can probably tell you which one it is at 3 a.m. in the morning. And I can tell you whether or not I should open my eyes or not. My littlest one would actually know that I knew he was there and I was purposely not on my eyes, and he would actually pry open my eyes and I would say to him, I am asleep. And he goes, no, you're not. I can see your eyes. One morning I had that kind of sensation about 5:45 in the morning, and I thought something is not right with the house. There's something, you're like, your spider sense goes off. Not that I'm a superhero. Spider sense has gone off. Something is wrong with the house. And I got up out of bed, opened the bedroom door, looked down the hallway. And the other end of the hallway, that door was open. And through that door, I could see the garage door was wide open. Oh, got up, raced down the hallway, looking in the boys' rooms and for the dog. And realised that our youngest son, Oliver, who was probably about 5 or 6 at the time, was missing. And I'm thinking to myself the whole time, have we been robbed? Has somebody abducted one of the children? There's something wrong. And I race out into the street with this thought in my mind, in my pyjamas, scanning up and down the street looking for my lost child. And I spotted him. He was down the street at a neighbour's house banging on the door. And I yelled out, Oliver! Oliver, what are you doing? And he turned around and I noticed that in his hand was an ice cream bucket. And he's walking with his ice cream bucket and he toddled over to me and I said, Oliver, almost hysterical. What are you doing? He said, oh, it's simple, Dad. I'm selling garden rocks to the neighbours. I said, it is before 6 o'clock on a Sunday morning. Nobody wants to buy your rocks on a Sunday morning. He looked at me and he said, that's not true. I've sold 2 already. And showed me, he showed me 2 gold coins that were in his hands. And then he toddled off quite happily back to his room, I think to dream of how that may be spent at tuck shop the next day at school. There is no greater fear for a family if you lose a family member, whether it's a child or a relative or a friend that you consider to be part of your family. Or to think that the safety of your house has been violated by someone breaking in. And God knows this. God is a relational God who created us and is in perfect relationship himself, understands this and in himself provides a refuge for us in our lives. Psalm 46 tells us, we will not fear though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and the foam and the mountains quake with surging. God is our refuge and strength, our very present help in time of need. You know, families come in all shapes and sizes. Some are made up of friends who flat together. Some have generations under one roof. Some are a couple doing life together. However, some may only find family in church. The other places and spaces of their life may be lonely, broken, dysfunctional, or disconnected. So church is a critical place in their world to find love, relationship, and belonging. And I realise that new life may be for some their only true sense of home, a place where they find a seat at the table, a place where there is safety, a place where they can weather the storms. We, you and me, are called to be salt, holding on to the preserving the truths of God, but also light, shining his love and finding a way, providing a genuine alternative to a broken and fallen world. Because we are God's family, and God's family finds a way. When people walk through these doors here, they should see a family in action, a family that is selfless, a family that is willing to sacrifice, a family that serves each other, a family who spends time with each other doing life together, a family that can weather the storms and the difficulties, a family that knows everyone needs to feel safe to flourish. When people look through these doors, they should see the Father heart of God. When people look through these doors, they should see the broken and the lonely being valued and loved. When people look through these doors, they should see a glimpse of the kingdom of God. In families, there's always space for one more. And our hope that one more is you. Let me pray for you. Father God, I just thank you for each person who's come here this morning. It has not been a mistake. Father God, we know that you draw us unto yourself. And in the circumstances that each person here finds himself in, Lord God, I pray that you would minister to them. Father God, your love is so great and powerful. The love that we see from you in the Trinity, the love that you had in creating us, the love that you had in putting us in relationship. Help us to be that love, to show the power of your love in the way that we bring people to the table to provide a space for them. And as we go out into this world, may people see the power of your love in action by the way that we treat people as family, in the way that we bring them to the table, to the way that we make a space, that all may know who you are and bring glory to you. And we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.